shaped. It's flexible. Hallelujah. So we need to look deep into ourselves. Am I a fish? Slippery. Fighting to get out of hands because I know that in the river, that's where my life is. That's where I get everything from. Or am I a clay in the potter's hand? Dead. Whether you shape me straight, I cannot complain. Whether I'm round, that's why there are different shapes of clay. Shapes. You'll find that others are, it says clay, others are flat, others are square. They have been shaped the way the potter wanted them. Remember, when the potter shapes you, he shapes you in a way that he can release what he has in him into you. If you are supposed to be a vessel, he will shape you until you become a vessel. And he knows that you are able to contain what's going to release unto you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you are going to be a big pot, he'll make you a big pot. He knows, you will know your capacity. It's important to know that when you are dead, you are shapeable. Am I talking to someone?
Amen.
When you are dead, you are shapeable. You can get the shape. The potter can shape you as he wants to. Most people are too much alive. When the potter wants you to make a vessel, no, I saw a beautiful tray. I'd rather be that tray. And I've never seen anybody go into the river with a tray to fetch water. If you've seen that person, then they might be probably in Sterkfontein or in Vescopis. Hallelujah. Ask your neighbor. Say, neighbor, how dead are you?
How dead are you?
How broken are you? It's important. No one can totally surrender to Christ whilst you're still full of yourself. Remember, we're talking about divine acceleration. One of the things that make people enjoy driving their cars, I'm thinking about normal cars, is that cars don't respond to themselves. They respond to what you are doing. Am I talking to someone? Cars respond to what? To what you are doing. They've never responded to them. Unless otherwise it's malfunctioning, if there's something wrong with the engine, then that car won't respond. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Ask your neighbor, say, neighbor,
neighbor.
How dead are you?
How dead are you?
How broken are you?
How broken.
That's key. You see, the growth of a child of God is not in you being you. It's when you are dead, you are able to grow. That's why the Bible always compares us as a seed. A seed is always, where a seed is, I don't think many people can cope, like if you can become a seed tomorrow. Because a seed is in the dark, buried. It cannot see who's coming with water. It cannot see who's, it cannot check the cloud whether it's about to rain or not. It's somewhere buried in the dark, in the soil. The only thing that keeps the seed alive is the faith on the owner, the one who sowed the seed. It doesn't even get to choose the soil. No, it's not nice being a seed. Ne? That's why some of the seeds fell in rocky ground, others fell in thorns, others fell in good soil. they all produce accordingly. So in the law of total surrender, listen, before I can go to the Bible, your faith works based on how surrendered are you to God. Amen. Okay. I can see that, the amen. Your faith works on the dead you are, the more faith you have. The more dead you are, if you are dead, if there's such a word, the more faith you have. Our titles remove faith from us. How can me, the prophet of the prophets, the evangelist, not get this? Well, God is saying, this one is not for a prophet. This one is not for an evangelist. This one is for a child of God. Are you a child before you are a prophet? You know, one pastor said something so profound in the Bible. He said there are a lot of men of God out there who have never been children of God. Amen. I'm not sure if somebody got it. Men who have never been children. Okay, let's go to the book of Exodus. I want you to look at something. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro. Exodus chapter 3, verse 1. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law. Oh, before I could thank you all for the lovely messages. They are really appreciated. You know, as pastors, you are always giving attention. I don't know, receiving attention feels so good. Amen. It feels so good. Just one happy birthday message to me is equal to 1,000 likes on Facebook. That's how I value them. One happy birthday message is called to 1,000 likes on Facebook. That's how I value you. Thank you very much. Keep them coming until 12 o'clock midnight. If you do that after 12 midnight tonight, you are irrelevant. My birthday was yesterday. Amen. Say, now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. He led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of a bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. Then Moses said, I will not turn aside and see this great sight. Why the bush does not burn? So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. And he said, do not draw near this place. Take your sandals. Underline the word sandals. What does sandals mean? Take your sandals off your feet, for the place you stand is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have currently seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. For I know their sorrows. So I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them from the land of a good and large land to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hittites and the Jebusites. Yeah, there are a lot of sites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come to me. I have also seen their oppression which the Egyptians oppressed them. Come now, therefore, I will send you to Pharaoh. Underline the word Pharaoh. that you may bring my people, the people of Israel, out of Egypt. May God bless his word. Father, I thank you that you are the God who speaks. Holy Spirit, you know our hearts. Let your grace speak. Let your grace reign. I thank you that you are about to speak. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. We know this story of Moses. We know the burning bush. Even the Sunday school knows about the burning bush. We know Moses. We know the father-in-law. But I want us to go back before the burning bush. Moses was thrown in the river by his mother just to save him from the dangers of being killed by Pharaoh, because he was killing all the sons of the Israelites. And Moses, to cut the long story short, Moses was found by Egyptian princess. He was adopted as a prince because Pharaoh didn't have boys. Pharaoh didn't have boys, only had girls. And the eldest girl found Moses. So to Pharaoh, Moses was a blessing from God. He was going to be a future king of Egypt because Pharaoh lacked male seed. So that grew in Moses. It grew inside Moses. Even though Moses was born to be a deliverer, but because of the privileges he had, he forgot who he was. He forgot the purpose. So God has to take him out of the palace to break him until he's usable again. Okay. Somebody's not getting this. Tabitha just said it. And church, are we together? God has to take Moses out of the palace to break him because he was no longer fit for purpose. Okay, I'm going to say this again. God has to take Moses out of the palace to the wilderness to break him because he was no longer fit for purpose. In between, Moses killed an Egyptian. We know that, ne? Because according to Moses, he understood his role that, but he did it his own way, not God's way. He was not yet surrendered to God. He was still Moses, the Egyptian prince. To see how Moses was an Egyptian, when the Jethro's daughters, when they met Moses by the well, they said, an Egyptian fought for us. If you read your Bible, they thought Moses was an Egyptian. They said, an Egyptian fought for us against other what? Headsmen. That's why we were able to get to water our cattle first. So Moses, even though he was in the wilderness, he was still an Egyptian. How dead are you to serve? You know, some of the prayer points that you bring to us, we don't want to tell you that, no, you are there because God is breaking you. It's not a demonic attack. God is breaking you. He wants you to be usable. He doesn't want to use an Egyptian prince. Okay. You come from Egypt with the titles of Egypt. Born again, but Egypt is still in the head. Nobody tells me what to do. Where I'm coming from, in my family, I tell people what to do. Church, are we together? Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, not all wilderness experiences are from the devil. Sometimes Moses has to be taken out of Egypt to be wilderness, to the wilderness, in order to encounter God. Moses was not going to encounter a burning bush in Pharaoh's orchard or garden.
Amen.
Yeah, the amens today, you remind me of last week. You see, the divine acceleration is not for the Egyptians. A burning bush accelerated Moses back to Egypt, but this time as a deliverer.
Amen.
You see, you are seated there. You might be calling yourself a worshiper or a pianist or usher whatsoever.
Amen.
But God has a purpose. You are saving because God has seen the oppression of his people out there. When they come in here, they can't run away from Egypt to Egypt. Am I talking to someone? They can't run away from Egypt to where? To Egypt. Listen, God said, take off your sandals, your ways that you know, take them off. You know how you walk, take it off.
Amen.
You have got experience of doing this, take it off.
Amen.
You knew about this before you were born again, take it off.
Amen.
I want you to experience me. You cannot come to me with sandals of experience. You will hurt my people in the church. You cannot come to me with sandals of your position from the Egyptian world. You will hurt my people in the church. Am I talking to someone? As a ministry, as a church, if we want to be effective, if you want to experience God, take off your sandals. When you walk through that door, when you walk through that gate, when you go before God, take off your sandals. God doesn't want to know your history. God didn't say to Moses, I forgive you for killing the Egyptian. No, that history did not exist to God. Moses, you are a sinner. You ran away. You are an outlaw. The Egyptians' law authorities are looking for you. That history did not matter to God. What mattered to God is that I have seen the oppression of my people. I'm not sure if somebody's getting this. I have seen the oppression of my people. Moses, if you were still alive in Egypt, you were going to be part of the oppression.
Amen.
Family, how ready are we to die? God has seen the oppression of his people next door. Your neighbor does not know Christ. Your colleague does not know Christ. We have used Christianity as a title, not purpose. Christianity is not a title. It's purpose driven. Acts 11:26, the Christians were first named Christian in Antioch. Why? They moved like Christ. They were concerned about souls like Christ. They had compassion for people like Christ. They loved the sinners like Christ. And they were saying that these ones are like Christ. They are Christians. Christians. They are little Christ. Am I turning to someone? Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor. Moses, as a prince, is useless. Moses, as a prince, is useless. Moses, as a shepherd, useful. I don't know why God has got this thing with shepherds. David, I will make you a king. A shepherd. Moses, take my people out of Egypt. Shepherd. Elijah, they don't know. Elisha was a shepherd. Those who didn't know. Shepherd. Let us read the Bible. Did another sandals again? And he said, I'm sending you to Pharaoh. You know, listen, whenever there is purpose, there will be an obstacle. Amen. If you are saving, you are not ready to confront your Pharaoh, you will never be effective in whatever that you are doing. Whenever God send a person, when Elijah was sent, there was Jezebel. When Jesus Christ rose up, they were Pharisees. John, the Revelator, was boiled by oil. He has to encounter, he saw without eyes. Church, are you ready to confront your Pharaoh?
Amen.
Your Pharaoh might be pride. And we're talking about dying to self, total surrender. Your Pharaoh might be pride. Your Pharaoh might be low self-esteem. God cannot use someone like me. Whenever God sends you, there will be a Pharaoh. Your Pharaoh might be right in your family. Until you defeat your Pharaoh in you, or besides you, or next to you, you will never reach the Red Sea. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor. Who is your Pharaoh? No, say like, so neighbor, are you ready to die to yourself? Let us look at Moses again. Because Moses, now when God said to him, go to Pharaoh, he said, God, I have survived that man for 40 years. Now I must go back again to be killed. Because they were looking for me. And God said, I am has sent you. Blank check. I am that I am has sent you. Then Moses died to self. The moment Moses died, he was buried there by the burning bush. Let me show you something. That, you know, when you encounter God, ask him to bury you there. Moses, the real Moses who ran away from Egypt, was buried by the burning bush. And the Moses with purpose, the Moses on the mission, was birthed out of the burning bush. Do you know why your Pharaoh is defeating you? Because you are going back as you. Die. Die. Maureen must not be alive.
Amen.
God, I'm coming to you. Maureen is the one who knows how to sing. I don't know you. I don't know the Maureen who can sing. Maureen must die. Maureen must go there. As Maureen who knows nothing. God, they say I can sing, but you know me better. Search my heart, O God. Remove that which is preventing me from fellowshipping with you as I ought to. Search my heart and see if there's any wicked ways in me. That's the person that God wants to encounter. Not a perfect person. You know, if you want to see God moving in your life, go die. God, I've just raised a dead person yesterday. God, I'm coming. No, that was yesterday. Between yesterday, after raising a dead person, and now in my encounter, what has happened? God wants a dead church. City tabernacle of all nations. If we are dead, no one will be offended by anyone. If you want to see that, go to the mortuary and see all dead people. Yeah, you big-headed. No one will respond. No one will respond. They are dead. You did this yesterday before you died. No one will respond. They are dead. When you are dead in Christ, you live for the glorification of Jesus Christ. His heart becomes your heart. His purpose becomes your purpose. I mean, how can God approach a single man to go and fight against the whole superpower of that time, Egypt? One man. I want to show you that the issues in your life are not issues. It's because you are alive to see them. Go to Pharaoh. And Pharaoh had military. He had soldiers. Eh? He had one of the best chariots. Egypt was the superpower then. No country could defeat Egypt then. They were the center of civilization. Mathematics started there. And God is looking at Moses. After Moses was broken down. Now today you're not going to take notes. You'll be listening. I'm doing it on purpose because I know that there are no pointers to write down notes. You'll be holding your pen like Mamruti like this forever. Like. there are no pointers. I want you to listen. Listen at how God is looking at you. He's looking at the mighty Egyptian government. He said, no, I'm not saying go and form a terrorist group. I'm not saying go and form a terrorist cell. I'm not saying go and learn how to manufacture bombs. Go there and say, I am has sent me. And you can only say that when you are dead. Because a normal person, listen, in his normal state of mind, can never go and approach a government and said, I am a sent me. You will think twice. They've got soldiers. They might hang me. I might be stabbed with spears. But how do you go there and approach a government like that? It's because he was dead. The issue that looks big in your life is not big. Die. My truth, someone? Ah, Pastor, I thought maybe you'll be praying for us. You'll be no, you don't need deliverance. You need to die. We don't need deliverance. See, there are important things that you have to know in this scripture of Moses. Come now. Who is calling you to come? God. I will send you. That's key. As to who he's sending you to doesn't matter anymore. Who is sending you? Some of us haven't come to God yet. Come, I will. Who called you matters. Amen. Learn to introspect. Why do I think the way I think? You ever ask yourself that question? Why do I apply my mind the way I apply? What is the source of my thoughts? If you understand the one who sent you, the one who sent you, the one who called you, the one who saved you, should be the source of your thoughts. Church, let's talk. That's why I love Galatians 2:20 so much. I love it. It is no longer I who lives. It is no longer I who lives. It is no longer I who lives. Once that sink to your spirit man, your thought process will change. It is no longer I who lives. When it's no longer you who lives, then your purpose changes. Offense comes when it is you who lives and your purpose is in the forefront. Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor. God is sending you to Pharaoh. And Pharaoh is stubborn. And Pharaoh has to be dealt with by, thus says the Lord. Thus says the Lord? The word of God. Until the word of God gains superiority in your life, you are not ready to face your own Pharaoh. If Moses sent this, Moses, who are you? Hey, Pharaoh, I don't want to know. I saw a burning bush. So you want to come and tell him that you want people to go because of the burning bush? Guys, please go hang this guy. That's what's going to happen to Moses. But Moses said, who are you, Moses? I am has sent me. I don't know what was inside the word I am. Because the word I am that I am weakened Pharaoh and his military might, and he began to focus on one man, Moses, with a rod. So who sent you, whoever sent you, will give you the word to speak. Listen, in your life, whatever you confront, speak, thus says the Lord. The word of God has everything that you need to accelerate you forward. After 400 years, 430 years, to be precise, in Egypt, the Israelites were expecting a military might to come and invade Egypt and release them. Not a man with a rod to accelerate them out of Egypt. Listen, church. God, this is what I'm hearing in my spirit. The version of you now is not ready to move where God wants you to. That version must die. That version must die. When that version is dead, Bafuns, you will march to the palace like a madman. Say, who want to see me? I don't know, it's a man walking with a rod. You pass through the palace gates. I mean, I want you to be like your pastor. Use your imagination. How did Moses pass all the guard posts to go and meet the king? And he's a wanted man, by the way. He's got a bounty on his head. He killed an Egyptian and ran away. But the next thing, he walked back and walked through the guard post and walked right into the palace and start interrogating Donald Trump of the time. How did he do that? I will send you. Don't undermine the power behind who sent you. Hey? When the cops walked through the gate, nobody could question it, because Moses was dead. He walked right into the palace and said, Moses, let my people go. But that one is a sermon for another day. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, die to Christ. So say like, say, neighbor, die to Christ. Say, you have no ability to confront Pharaoh in your current version of yourself. The current version of yourself can never confront Pharaoh. Can never do that. Imagine Moses after hearing that, he said, guys, Israel, I've just met God. Israel, I just met God. Now, this is what we're going to do now. I met God. I'm sure I saw a burning bush. So we are going to group ourselves into little bands of armies. We are going to attack Pharaoh. I'm 100% of what I saw. I saw God. We are going to do it now. They were going to die within 24 hours. Listen, why I'm saying this, you might have seen God. You might have heard God and be born again. Now is time to be born again, again. Die. Amen. Galatians 2:20. Let us go there before we close. Moses, I've seen my people in Egypt go. Listen, Moses is not going there because he has become a superman. He's going there because God has seen his people. Oh.
Amen.
When the purpose of God is fully entrenched in a Christian's life. Can I repeat that? When the purpose of God is fully entrenched in a Christian life, you will know that you are going there because God said, I have seen my people. I need my people. They need somebody to worship. I've seen my people. They need someone to preach unto them. I've seen the children. They need a Sunday school teacher. Moses, are you ready? God, you know, in my flock, I've got a ram that is about to give birth, you know, and if I leave now, I don't know who will take care of it. No. Moses, in my flock, I've got a cow. God, I've got a cow in my flock that is about to give birth. If I leave now, I don't know who will take care of it. They are beasts in the wilderness. They can come and take this. No. Take care of my business. I will take care of your business.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
No, okay, let us now use logic for now. What happened to the flock that Moses was shepherding? After the burning bush experience, what happened to them? God is not that cruel that God does not hate Jethro, Moses' father-in-law. Because later on in the book of Exodus, we see Jethro coming up again. Say, Moses, you cannot lead these people all by yourself. Appoint elders who will help you to judge these people. Meaning, God took care of the flock. Took it back to Jethro's place by himself. No Moses. Oh, yeah. Okay. I'm not sure if somebody's getting this. That which you are worried about, that is preventing you from serving God fully, God can take better of it more than you by far. He can take care of it better than you by far. We don't see Moses and Jethro fighting after Moses was called. Even Jethro becomes a chief advisor. He didn't say, Moses, don't talk to me. I gave you cattle, sheep, and all that. You left them in the wilderness. They were eaten by wild beasts. No. The same burning bush took care of the flock. Moses died in a way that he even forgot the flock. What is your flock that is preventing you from confronting your own Pharaoh? What is your flock? Think about it. Oh God, I'll be saving you. It's just that. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor. Tell them. Die. Die to self. That which you believe you are taking care of, God can do it better than you. Tell your neighbor. Say, neighbor, God can do it better than you. Take care of his work. He will take care of your business. I told you to someone, I'm not encouraging you to be negligent. I'm encouraging you to die. There is a difference between a negligent person and a dead person. That one, I think I must touch it. Because some will say, you heard Mufun, Bafun, Mufundi sang it. Ne? So don't tell me about bathing the children. God will bath them. Muruti, don't tell me about eating. I'm not cooking. I'm sure just after 30 minutes, I take 2 hours to cook. After 2 hours, go check the pots. There should be something there. God will have done so. I'm not attending to do that. I'm saying to you, dying to self is giving the word of God the first priority in your life. Hallelujah. Listen, I always tell this to people. If it's not aligned with the word of God, I won't do it. That's me. And if it's aligned with the word of God, I will do it irrespective of the circumstances that will come after. Or whatever that will come, I will do it. Align yourself with the word of God. That's why you should be able to be bold and say, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live. Paul understood the death of Jesus Christ more than anybody else. He knew that when Christ was on the cross, he was dying also. The man understood the Jews said that, they said that even when they stoned him, he woke up. They stoned him for the gospel. He woke up, next seat, preached the gospel. That is successfully confronting your Pharaoh. That is successfully confronting your Pharaoh. It is no longer I who live. Pastor Dagada, the man of the moment. You want to know that I'm not the man of the moment. Let God decide that I'm coming back home. It will be men from the man of the moment, it will be men of the funeral to show that I've got no authority. I'm telling you, I have no power. So I might as well die while I'm still alive. Imagine to someone, I have no power. I might as well die while I'm still alive and enjoy the fruits of dying while I'm still alive. Because when I'm really dead, I don't know the fruits. Except that I'll be with the Father. But I want to enjoy the one that, if you want to be, listen, heaven on earth is for those who are dead in Christ. I'm not getting you. Heaven on earth is those who are what? Who are dead in Christ. You want to live in order, heaven on earth, but you are alive in Egypt. Nobody talks to me like that. You must know me. Nobody. But this is what, nobody talks to me this way. No one. But that says the word of, no, go tell God that I'm saying no. That's Pharaoh. And where did he end up? In the middle of the Red Sea with his troop. Hallelujah. Amen. Listen, every Pharaoh that will follow you, their destiny is the Red Sea. Amen. You are not getting it. Hallelujah. You are victorious before you fight. You are victorious before you fight. No, I'd rather be dead, man. It's better that way. That's why I say today you won't take notes. We're dying to self. You are victorious before you fight. You see, Moses didn't have an army. Listen to this. But the waters dealt with the army. He crossed dry land. Dead people crossing the sea. The Egyptians who were alive came. And the water said, I know the instruction. I don't know. So, okay, allow us to get, no. But in fact, our instruction is to get rid of you. When you are dead, God will get rid of your own Pharaoh. Listen, be crucified with Christ. What does to be crucified with Christ mean? You seek that which glorifies Christ. When you wake up in the morning, Jesus Christ, what do you want me to do today? What is my assignment for the day? You might be going to work. You might be going to the taxi rank. Once you do that, God will set up circumstances that will make you successfully execute your assignment. You'll find yourself doing things that you never thought you would do because you are dead. The hand of the Lord came upon Elijah. He ran faster than what? The chariots. That man died first. If he was alive, his bones will be broken, will going to be broken because of the speed that carried him. Am I talking to someone? Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I can't hear you. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. It is no longer I who lives. But let us read the next one. But Christ lives in me. Listen to this. I want you to know this. If Christ lives in you, what did Christ do while still on earth? He healed the sick. The blind eyes were open. The lame walked. The deaf ears were open. This everything that Christ did, if he lives in you, why can't he do the same? Because the Bible said that he's the same yesterday, today, and what? And forever. So if he lives in you, he can still do it. Hallelujah. That's why when you say a person is sick, I don't doubt. I don't say, it's corona. What am I going to do with it? No, no. It's what? They say you shall lay the hands on the sick and they shall be what? They shall recover. You shall cast out what? Demons. Hallelujah. There's somebody here. There's someone in your own land, in your own family, who's waiting for you to die. Cast out the spirit. It's no longer I who lives. In me. Say, neighbor, as Christ lives in you, victorious life is your portion. Am I talking to someone? Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You should be able to command circumstances. You should be able to command situations. They should change. Listen, Moses was not yet born again. He had God because Jesus Christ wasn't crucified yet. He had God and he walked with God and he did what God told him to do and he became victorious. Christ was not in him. He heard the word. You are better than him by far. You are better than Moses by far. Christ is in you. No, you're not getting me. Church. Christ is in you. Christ is in you. Say, neighbor, I'm preparing for my own funeral. I want to die and live in Christ. Say, the me in me has disappointed me many times. I want the Christ in me to give me the life of victory. Hallelujah. So the you in you has disappointed you several times. And the life and which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God. Why? Who loved me and gave himself for me. Wow. Jesus Christ is calling you to die into his love. We have been doing this. If you are married, you have died into somebody's love. You even change your surname if you are a woman. You change your surname. Now I'm telling you, the primary school girl who was called Nomama Buddha does not exist anymore. There was a transition. Your high school certificate is saying something else. Your marriage certificate is saying something else. So what I'm teaching you is not new. What I'm teaching you is not new. You even give birth, the people don't even carry your surname. You carry them for 9 months. So it's not new. For women, it's not new. Maybe for men, yeah. I need to preach this sermon to men. Hallelujah. Yes. So when you die in love, when you die in love of Christ, what matters most is for your lover. What does Christ want me to do? How do I sing for him today? How do I usher for him today? How do I play the piano for him today? Once everything is done for Christ, listen to me, this church will be full tomorrow. Amen. Hallelujah. Yes, this church will be full tomorrow. Because God is saying, I've seen the oppression of my people, and I must send them somewhere. But they mustn't send them somewhere. People can say, okay. Please sit there. This side is for directors and managers and pastors, apostles and prophets. How do you die to yourself? Totally surrender your life to Jesus Christ. Totally surrender your life to the King of Kings. Hallelujah. Totally surrender. I'll be a clay in the potter's hand. Let him shape you the way he wants. Maybe you got a vision of yourself being shaped by like this because you saw in somebody else. That is for somebody else. Moses, the way Moses was called and the way Elisha was called is not the same. But they were all called to serve the same God. Hallelujah. Amen. The way Peter was called and the way Paul was called is not the same. Paul has to see a light. He has to see lightning. Peter just has to say, come, I'll make you fishers of men. He said, oh, what? Okay. It's fine, I'm dying. I'm dying to fishing. I'm going to listen to this man. And we'll never see Peter's family going around begging for food. No. For the 3 years of Jesus' ministry, Peter's family was taken care of. He died. How many of you are ready to die? Ask God. Say, God, expose my Pharaoh to me and equip me to deal with that Pharaoh. Hallelujah. I don't know what your rod will be. Expose my Pharaoh. Whenever God sent you, there is a Pharaoh waiting for you. I know what I'm talking about. You might be thinking that, no, we are too few in this church. To me, it's an achievement. Irrespective of the number, the pharaohs that we have to go through to be where we are as a church, To me, it's an achievement. According to Satan, this church should have been closed down. But the testimonies that came out of here, the miracles that came out of here, to me, it's an achievement. And even to this day, we're still dealing with that Pharaoh. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
How many of you are ready to be victorious in your life? Do you want victory in your life? Do you want to live a life of victory? Die to yourself. Be broken. Can all stand up? You know, it's easy to listen to a sermon like this and be excited and come back next week the way you came in today. It's easy. Dying to self is an effort. And that effort needs prayer. And that effort needs dedication and commitment to the word. Dying to self doesn't just happen overnight because you wish it. It's intentional. It's intentional. And it's a process. It doesn't happen overnight. Like the Egyptians, like the Israel from Egypt, they were not delivered from Egypt overnight. It was a process. All Egyptian gods had to be dealt with. Starting with the god of the Nile until the god of the firstborn. They all have to be dealt with. Listen, my dear sister. Listen, my dear brother, son and daughter. You don't have a problem. You are alive. There is no issue. You are alive. Am I talking to someone? There is no problem. You are alive. Jesus wants you to die in him. Then you can say, in him I live. You cannot live in him until you die in him. So what you believe is a problem. I'm not downplaying genuine problems. But there are certain issues that die when we die. I've never seen a dead man coughing. Say, hey, kupela tissue mo kitswama mina. A dead man coughing, no, give me a tissue. I need to blow my nose. Those are not the things for a dead man.